The very fact that the governments, businesses, and policymakers have failed to act will galvanize citizens into action. The more years pass, the hotter our planet gets, the more discord there is among us. We're in a calm before the storm, not just in terms of climate, but also in terms of civil unrest, revolution, lawsuits, extremism, and chaos that will result from it.
I'd like to thank you all for coming to another Scientist's Warning TV program. My name's Stuart Scott. Victoria Hirth, at the other end of the table, is our co-host. And we're coming to you live from COP24, the Conference of Parties in Katowice, Poland. Victoria is an Associate Professor of Sustainable Business with the University of Plymouth. I'm the Executive Director of ScientistsWarning.org and a member of Climate University, shall we say. Today's guests we have with us, Victoria Leonie Alina and their teacher, Bruce Phillips. And they are all attending or teaching at the International School in Berlin. And today's program, we're calling Climate Education is Screwed Up. Take it away.
This is the current situation. The countries you see behind me in red are currently unsustainable. This is the total ecological footprint. And the largest chunk of the red you see there is the carbon footprint. The countries in green are currently sustainable. The question is for how long? All the while we're using fossil fuels, every country that's currently green is going to go red. The countries that are already in red are going to get redder. Eventually, they'll go from being in deficit into debt.
And we're all aware that for how long question specifically refers to Brazil, well, among other countries, where they've just elected a right-wing president who has promised to destroy the Amazon for business, for money. Human civilization, all of humanity, is being held hostage by our economic system. I say this every chance I get. Our system of money and economics is killing us.
Martin Luther King once said, "There's no human circumstance more tragic than the persisting existence of a harmful condition for which a remedy is readily available." So how do you remember Martin Luther King? As shallow? As power insatiable? No. Thinking back to his ideologies, he was courageous, appreciated, and at that time, innovative. Back then, Dr. King realized that many millions of people were either essentially ignorant of our conditions or refused to face unpleasant truths.
Those who hoped that the Negro needed to blow off steam and will now be content will have a rude awakening if the nation returns to business as usual.
We're talking about an important and alarming observation that has been made over 50 years ago. Since then, fashion has progressed, technology has progressed, pretty much anything has progressed, but not government's effective response to global issues. Like school students, you rely on procrastinations. But you're not dealing with a paper that can be written an hour before the deadline. You're dealing with a whole planet populated by 7.6 billion people and organisms that support our survival. Even if humanity's thinking often does not exceed a single generation, the damage is evident today, which is not a surprise to anybody here. So being completely aware of the imminent severe dangers, let's take a look at your responses in reducing fossil fuels. Are you kidding? This is the world that you leave behind to your families, to your future children. This is just shameful. I have no words.
I want to emphasize, we've been talking for 25 years, and all the time our fossil fuel use has been going up exponentially. Talk, talk, talk. When are we going to stop talking and start doing something?
The rate at which we use renewable energies does not function as a compensation for this. And renewable energies do not serve as an alibi for governments to appear like they're combating climate change. First and foremost, they have to replace and thereby reduce the emission of fossil fuels to a minimum. Does this graph depict such action? No. The results are just as futile as your promises. The fact is that eventually we will have to change to other energy resources. And then it's going to be too late, because there will be no civility that requires your economic and political organization. If the value of humanity and the natural world is not enough, and you continue to increase fossil fuel consumption at this rate, you're shooting yourself in the foot.
Because I don't know what else to do. This is the only option I have left to play my part and deal with this problem, so I'm prepared to be arrested for it. I don't know what else to do now, so here I am.
Here, I have the United Nations Climate Change Secretariat Progress Tracker from October 22, 2018. The only thing that says is develop, update, convene a facilitative dialogue among parties. I mean, is that what my existence depends on? I mean, this is not valuable at all.
Conference after conference, you invite students to speak and urge you to take action. Our question is, when will you actually start hearing our cries for help? When will our words finally matter to you? If you are unwilling to take action, make way for someone who isn't afraid to tell it like it is, and then act on it. Martin Luther King wouldn't have sidestepped the facts, and neither will we.
We millennials will be the bearers of the damage that collective inaction has caused. When we imagine our future, we fear a world of poverty, degradation, and critical resource depletion. We fear a world where changing weather patterns threaten the resources that our very lives depend on.
Being aware of our future responsibility to combat negative impact on climate change, we're not only confronted with your past, frivolous actions, but also the lack of accurate knowledge. As students, we cannot stress enough how much importance and responsibility the education of climate change carries, since the embedded information and ideology is the base of our future actions. Or are you seriously expecting us to turn the Titanic from the iceberg without giving us a compass and a map? Even if the whole of humanity would follow the suggestions manifested in current textbooks, the outcome will be ineffective. This is not us being pessimistic. This is us realizing initial reasons for weak outcomes. Here are the individual actions recommended for mitigating climate change in multiple school science and geography textbooks from some of the highest emitting countries. These are familiar to everyone who's had an education in these countries, but there is a major problem here.
Okay, so since the late 1980s and 1990s when I was at school, this is actually my textbook. Okay, from the 80s and 90s. I was going to bring a modern textbook, but the advice that's in here is exactly the same as it was 30 years ago. The vast majority of textbooks mention recycling. Behind me, you can see the tons of CO2 equivalent avoided per year for one person undertaking this action. Okay, recycling was mentioned the most. Plant-based diet wasn't mentioned at all. Not in one textbook. Buying green energy wasn't mentioned in any textbook. Avoiding one long-haul flight, or avoiding flying, was only mentioned in a couple of textbooks, 2 out of 10. And don't own a car was barely mentioned at all. But one thing that is missing from this list that has a greater impact than all of these put together, and this is a big problem, because at the moment, our education of students in schools is totally ineffective. Telling them to recycle when it only saves 0.21 tons of CO2 equivalent, okay, and bear in mind, we all live in, we're from Berlin, bear in mind it's around 8 to 10 tons per person. Changing your light bulbs or recycling is going to do diddly squat. It's going to make no major significant difference. My students went away, they went out, they did their research, They looked up this paper, Vines and Nicholas, from the Environmental Research Letters from last year, 2017. This is what they found out. The biggest single action one individual can take, and we're not telling students it. 58.6 tons. That's greater than all of the other actions that were mentioned in every textbook that we looked at. We looked at 26 different actions in textbooks. The vast majority of the ones that were mentioned are ineffective.
And how many times is this mentioned?
None. Not a single textbook that I could find from the last 30 years. Not a single one. Now, bear in mind that this is looking particularly at high emission countries, okay? High emission countries. This is looking at the richest countries. It's a huge, huge thing, and none of my students know this. I went round earlier, I showed people a piece of paper with this on, without the 58.6 tons on, without the information on there, and I said, what is this big question mark? What's missing here? And I couldn't find a single person here that could answer that question correctly.
It's also a very cultural thing, isn't it? You know, having children and having a certain number of children is a norm that's passed down through society, and is quite a hard one, having one child myself and hearing all the questions about why I'm not having more, I realise how strong that norm is.
Yeah, I mean, the interesting thing about this, we were looking, okay, where could we act on this where it's a win-win situation? And one of the interesting things is, I don't know if you're aware of this, in the United States, for example, the unintended pregnancy rate is 45%. That adds around 1 million unintended births, not necessarily unwanted, but unintended pregnancies in 1 year. That's an extra 1 million US footprints per year added. And this is something that people don't necessarily want. I think this is a case of poor sex education. I think it's a case of not reliable enough contraceptives. And this is very much in rich countries that aren't getting this right.
So to reiterate, not once was choosing to have one fewer child mentioned in one of these textbooks. Not once. Governments, you are fucking up our education. But as radical as it might sound, we're simply adding too many people to this planet through unintended pregnancies, and for people being unaware of how their choices impact this planet. If you're convinced that you can deal with climate change while we're adding the equivalent of the entire population of London every single month, then, as Sir David Attenborough has said, you're either a madman or an economist. I know some say they're worried about their population's aging, but being brutally honest, not only does climate change outweigh the risks of an aging population, but if it becomes as bad as expected, there won't be an aging population at all. If we tackle the problems of unintended pregnancy and family planning access, we would not only make our climate solutions easier, we would also see multiple positive benefits for many of the UN Sustainable Development Goals, which all of you adopted. With less unintended pregnancies, inequality and conflict over resources, such as food and clean water, would fade, simultaneously diminishing civil unrest. The government's expenses for education will decrease, educational opportunity will rise, and unemployment and crime rates will recede. This action of making sure every pregnancy is intended and the education of proper solutions will help us reach the goal of this conference, climate change action.
People are empowered to stand up for their rights, their lives, and their ideologies. May I remind you that the role of every government is to protect their citizens, and there will be consequences once people don't feel protected anymore. The insecurity will either weaken the authoritative position of a government due to the faded trust, or a populist power will take advantage of the civil unrest and repeat the mistakes of the 1930s. Do not underestimate the wrath of a feared humanity. Anger feeds on fear. And we are afraid.
Whew. I didn't expect it to be this powerful.
Could we perhaps ask you on an individual, personal level, having gone through this process of understanding the situation we're in. Going from a situation, from what I understand, where you almost knew nothing about climate change until one teacher took it on themselves to teach you. What do you feel, as a result of that, has changed about you personally and in your lives? Has it changed your future direction and what you do and what you think you will be doing?
Well, for me personally, it was a very reflective experience because I tend to view myself as a very conscious person, and I always thought that recycling and changing light bulbs would be good enough. But hearing something so radical, something that changed my entire viewpoint, made me reflect on a multitude of factors on my life, and it was really a reflective experience because it changes your complete viewpoint of a matter, and it kind of shows you that there is never something that you know enough about, and that there is always external factors that you should learn about.
For me, I feel obliged now to spread this information, spread the news, because if it is a surprise for me and for us, then it's probably, and if many of you, of people, were not able to tell what the biggest impact on climate change was, then it's our duty for those who know what it is to inform you, to enlighten you. And this is why we're also here. This is why we embarked on this journey to tell you about this, so you can reflect on this issue, and we will also be more engaged in our school and inform them.
And I encourage everyone watching this, if you're still in school, strike on Fridays. If you have children, encourage your children to strike on Fridays. Our children are trying to wake us up now, and we're not getting it. We've got to get it. We'd like to thank these organizations for helping us produce these shows. And if you speak two languages, please help us translate the videos that we've got. There's an email address to contact us. Again, thank you very much for Victoria and myself and our guests. There's a contact address for us, and we're coming to you live from the UN climate negotiations in Katowice, Poland.